Hello, comrades. It's the Finnish Bolshevik. We're going to be continuing my Communism for Beginners series, and you can think of this sort of as a season two. It's going to be a brand new book, Left-Wing Communism and Infantile Disorder by Lenin. Classic work. Every Marxist should read this at least once. It's a very short book, but it covers a lot of things, a lot of topics, and it's really a sign of a great work. When I started looking through this to make some notes, and right from the beginning, it just has so many good points. And keep in mind, I've already read this twice. I read this way back in the day, years ago, and then I read it again. And now that I'm returning to it for the third time, I'm still seeing all these things like, wow, that's such a good point, and that's so thought-provoking and whatnot. So if I had to summarize what this book is about, I would say that it's about practical Leninist tactics more than anything else. It also has ideology. It contrasts the Leninist ideology to a reformist ideology and also to an ultra-leftist ideology. But it kind of deals with that more in the realm of practice, practical activity. So it talks a lot about dictatorship of the proletariat, the party, elections, trade unions, just all kinds of stuff. So let's just get right into it. I recommend that you read it yourself, or if you don't want to read, you would prefer to listen. There is an audiobook version that I have made, link in the description. But with that said, let's just go right into it. So first, a couple words about context. So this was written by Lenin in 1920, and he wanted to get it done for the Second Congress of the Comintern. So the Second Congress of the Communist International, that's where representatives of all the different communist parties of the world would meet. So Lenin wrote this short book about some current issues in the movement, and then when all the representatives of the communist parties of the world came to the Congress of the Comintern, everybody was given a copy of Lenin's book so they could read it. And after that, it went to broader circulation. So that's the context. The year is 1920. The first chapter, it's very short. It's called, In What Sense We Can Speak of the International Significance of the Russian Revolution. That's the question he poses. In what sense can we speak of the international significance of the Russian Revolution? What is the international significance of it? This book, in some ways, has a similar feel to Stalin's Foundations of Leninism, because it talks about how Leninism is defined and also the historical roots of it. This covers some topics that are similar. So, Lenin says, quote, I am speaking of it in the narrowest sense of the word, taking international significance to mean the international validity or the historical inevitability of a repetition on an international scale of what has taken place in our country. It must be admitted that certain fundamental features of our revolution can possess that significance. So, by international significance, he means that which in the Russian Revolution, the October Revolution, or the Bolshevik Revolution, that thing which is valid for all countries, which is bound to be repeated in other countries, as he says, international validity or historical inevitability of a repetition on an international scale. So there's something there which is not just a one-time fluke in one place, but is valid for other countries too. And he says, it must be admitted that certain fundamental features of our revolution possess that significance. So yeah, there are some things like that. And he continues, quote, it would, of course, be grossly erroneous to exaggerate this truth and to extend it beyond certain fundamental features of our revolution. It would also be erroneous to lose sight of the fact that, soon after the victory of the proletarian revolution in at least one of the advanced countries, a sharp change will probably come about. Russia will cease to be the model and will once again become a backward country in the Soviet and the socialist sense. So the first part of this, where he says, it would of course be grossly erroneous to exaggerate this truth and to extend it beyond certain fundamental features. He's saying that, of course, there's only those core things, the very core things that are universally applicable everywhere. But you can't, like, carbon copy the whole thing exactly the same way and think that it's gonna work, because every country is different, every country has different circumstances, every country has a different historical context, and so on and so forth, especially because this happened almost 100 years ago. So we can understand that there's something there which was a good idea, and we can try to apply that to our circumstance. But the circumstances are also so different that we can't just copy everything and think it's gonna work exactly the same way. And he says another thing that's interesting. He says that probably in the future, the revolution is going to spread so that one of the Western countries might have a revolution. You know, for example, Germany or France or the UK or US could have a revolution. And if that were to happen, then Russia wouldn't be the leading socialist country anymore, but instead one of these other countries would take that place. For example, Germany, or if the US had a socialist revolution, of course the US would be a more advanced country, technologically a more powerful country. Russia would cease to be the model and would once again become a backward country. And this comes from basically the context of their time, because nobody really expected that Russia would be the leading socialist country, because politically Russia was more backward. These other countries, these Western countries, had more liberal ideas, more progressive ideas. Capitalism was more developed in those countries. They had more political liberties, more political rights, and for that reason, socialists could work more freely. So everybody expected that a country like Germany, where the socialist movement was the most powerful, because they had more resources, they had more avenues available for them, and the whole country was politically more progressive. So everybody thought, yeah, it's probably going to be Germany or something that has the revolution. And Russia was kind of lagging behind. But then, what do you know? Russia is the one that has the revolution, and Russia becomes the leader of the international socialist movement, which is kind of weird and unexpected. And these days, we kind of take that for granted, but back then it was weird. So that's why he says, if one of these advanced countries would have a revolution, then Russia would go back to being just one of the lesser countries that's kind of lagging behind and following behind these other ones. And then he says, backward country in the Soviet and socialist sense, as in, it's not the leading socialist country anymore. He continues, quote, at the present moment in history, however, it is the Russian model that reveals to all countries something, and something highly significant, of their near and inevitable future. Advanced workers in all lands have long realized this. More often than not, they have grasped it with their revolutionary class instinct rather than realized it. Herein lies the international significance, in the narrow sense of the word, of Soviet power and of the fundamentals of Bolshevik theory and tactics. So, at least for the present time, you know, 1920, the Russian model has revealed something, because Russia was the one where revolution was successful. So everybody has to look at Russia and see, well, how come the Russians could do it and nobody else could? So there is something that Russia has revealed to everybody else. Then he says that advanced workers in all lands have long realized this, but more often than not, they have only grasped it with their revolutionary class instinct. So he contraposes class instinct to class consciousness. Class instinct is kind of just, you know, your proletarian gut feeling, but class consciousness is the fact that you're actually politically knowledgeable. You know what's happening, you actually understand how things work. And that's the international significance of two things, Soviet power and Bolshevik theory and tactics. So maybe this is a little repetitive, because we're just really like nitpicking this and really analyzing this. But I guess the main point is, the revolution was successful only in Russia, and there is a reason for that, so we have to examine that. And what was that reason? He outlines two things, two features that we need to look at more deeply, the Soviets and Bolshevism. Then he goes on to say, quote, the quote-unquote revolutionary leaders of the Second International, such as Kautsky in Germany and Otto Bauer and Friedrich Adler in Austria, have failed to understand this, which is why they have proved to be reactionaries and advocates of the worst kind of opportunism and social treachery. Now, he puts the word revolutionary in quotation marks, basically to be sarcastic or to be ironic. They're like fake revolutionary. They're revolutionary, but only in quotation marks. So these opportunist leaders of the Second International, Kautsky, Bauer, and Adler, haven't understood the significance of the Russian Revolution, which is quite an understatement, actually. And that's why they've proven to be reactionaries and worst kinds of opportunists and social traitors. Social treachery just means that you're a socialist, you're a leftist, but you're a traitor to leftism, traitor to socialism. They are traitors to socialism, so they are guilty of social treachery. We will probably get more into the differences between the different internationals, but basically a quick summary is that the First International was basically a thing where socialists from different countries came together to collaborate internationally. Marx and Engels were there, a lot of the early anarchists were there. One of the big splits in the First International was the Marxist versus anarchists. Then after the death of Marx and Engels, you had the Second International, which came to have a pretty dominant position. And that's when everybody started calling themselves social democrats. They were Marxists, they were socialists, that's why you get the term social, and democrats because they opposed monarchy and they saw as their most immediate goal right now was to overthrow monarchies and implement liberal democracy. So, social democrats. But they were Marxists. They were also dogmatic in a sense that they thought that the workers' revolution only had a chance of succeeding in countries that had liberal democracy because, according to a very rigid interpretation of Marxist theory, you kind of have to go like through these various modes of production. Like first you have primitive society, then you have slave society, then you get to feudal society, which has monarchy. Then you overthrow the monarchy, you get rid of all the medieval feudal stuff, and then you transition to capitalism and liberal democracy. And then, with capitalism, now you can really get the workers' movement going. So that's why they kind of thought that they have to focus heavily on just implementing democracy and overthrowing the monarchy, because they didn't really think that you could have a proletarian revolution before that, which is a very, you know, narrow way of looking at it. Russia is a perfect example. Russia still had a monarchy, and it was only overthrown in February 1917, and already in October 1917 they have a proletarian revolution. So Russia was one of the most backward countries where capitalism wasn't very developed, where they still had a monarchy, and then all of a sudden it just jumps and goes ahead with the proletarian revolution. I'm kind of just going on a big tangent, but this is important to understand to get the context of this. So the Second International is basically where everybody is. All the socialist parties of all the countries are in there. Then World War I happens, and there's a massive split between the so-called internationalists and the opportunists of various types. We'll get to the details of that a bit later, but basically the main point of the split was that most of the parties in the Second International had a stupid position on the First World War. You know, the motto of Marxism has always been workers of all countries unite, but when the war happened, these socialists of different countries, they kind of just went along with the war. They didn't take enough steps to prevent the war. They didn't say, no, hey, don't go killing workers of other countries. Instead, they kind of just went along with it, and they came up with different kinds of justifications. They said, oh, well, we have to defend ourselves, or we have to defend our proletariat against the proletariats of other countries. Especially since this wasn't a defensive war on anybody's part. The First World War was purely just countries trying to conquer, and especially fighting for other countries' colonies. So everybody in this war was an imperialist. Nobody was defending themselves, they were all trying to conquer shit. So that's why there was a split. The Bolsheviks, the Spartacist League in Germany, the Left Social Democrats in Sweden, to an extent the Finnish Socialists and some others, took the internationalist stance. So they said, no, we're not gonna fight in the war. So they split with everybody else. But we'll get to that in more detail. If that's all, you know, old news and obvious to you, then I apologize. But to those who don't know this already, this is kind of important. And then something happens. And you start to see that after this split, the parties of the Second International and the parties that left from the Second International, they're actually very different. It's not just that they disagree about the war. They all of a sudden disagree on a wide range of topics. The war was just kind of the last straw. And it turns out that the parties of the Second International are all just opportunists and reformists. And the people who left the Second International are actually communists, revolutionaries, and Marxists. And this becomes more and more apparent later on. So the revolutionary Marxists, they change their name from Social Democrats. They don't call themselves Social Democrats anymore. Instead, they just started calling their parties Communist Parties. And they create the Communist International, the Comintern, also known as the Third International. And that's where you develop the modern split between communists and social democrats. Social democracy still changed a little bit over time, but that's basically where it started. Until that point, they used to be the same thing, but obviously these days they're very different. Alright, so then we get to the next chapter, called An Essential Condition of the Bolsheviks' Success. And he says, quote, "It is, I think, almost universally realized at present that the Bolsheviks could not have retained power for 2.5 months, let alone 2.5 years, without the most rigorous and truly iron discipline in our party, or without the fullest and unreserved support from the entire mass of the working class, that is, from all thinking, honest, devoted, and influential elements in it, capable of leading the backward strata or carrying the ladder along with them." The first thing he stresses is discipline. And he stresses this a lot. He keeps going back to that. Most rigorous and truly iron discipline in our party. Now what does that mean? It means democratic centralism. It means that people stick to the common decisions of the party. Otherwise, it's not gonna work. They discuss, they come to conclusions, they enact decisions, and then everybody sticks to those decisions. Those decisions are either correct or incorrect, or maybe they're correct for the time, but then something changes and they're not correct anymore. Whatever the case may be, they will always have more discussions, like, you know, we had this decision, but do you think that that's still the correct thing to do? Maybe we should do this, maybe we should do that. The internal party discussion is always going to be happening, but when they have decisions, and when they have a political line, everybody has to stick to that line, and everybody has to stick to those decisions. If you want a little more information about this, you can check my video called Leninist Theory of the Communist Party. I will link that in the description. And the goal of this discipline is that the party stays united and stays on the same page about things. Because, for example, if you compare to the West European Social Democrat parties, these were really big parties, but they didn't really have well-defined political positions and well-defined political lines. They would typically try to make compromise positions, so they wouldn't really have to take a stand on anything. They would issue declarations that were really vague, so they wouldn't have to take a side. Or even if people had drastically different ideas, they would still remain in the same party. And Lenin talks about this more later on. But basically what that led to is that when they were supposed to have the revolution, turns out, we have a big party, but most of the people in this party are not revolutionaries. And the reason they didn't find that out until it was too late was because those parties always avoided having serious discussions, and they always avoided taking stands. They always said, like, yeah, revolution, sure, but they never actually took it seriously. Whereas with the Bolsheviks, they wanted to have a situation where everybody is on the same page, everybody actually knows and actually agrees what they're doing, so that when it's time to do it, they can actually do it. There are other aspects to discipline as well. There's the fact that the Bolshevik Party was for a long time an illegal underground party, or at least it had illegal underground components. It changed a lot, and he's gonna later on talk about the different stages in the history of Bolshevism. But sometimes the party would be illegal, sometimes the party would be legal, then it would go to being illegal again, and they had to adapt to that. They would have infiltrators, they would have agent provocateurs, which are basically people who infiltrate your party, then try to get your party to do something stupid. Typical example is that you would have some kind of demonstration, then a police infiltrator would infiltrate the demonstration, and then start a fight with the police, so then the police could beat up all the demonstrators, saying, hey, the demonstrator started a fight, so we had to beat them up, even though it was actually a police infiltrator who did that. There's actually a term in Russian working-class history called Zubatovshina, Zubatov Doctrine, I think it's called, or something along those lines. And Zubatov was a police agent who pretended to be a working-class activist, and he started trade unions. And the purpose of these trade unions was basically just to be, you know, to lure people into them so the police could get them. So in order to also avoid this kind of infiltration and sabotage and stuff like that, the Bolsheviks needed to have good discipline. And also, if you have a demonstration or something, you need to be well organized, and you need to have good discipline in your group, so that if somebody antagonizes you or provokes you, you don't start a fight with them. At least if it's supposed to be a peaceful demonstration, you know. I'm not really gonna get into the whole peaceful demonstration versus something else, but I'm just saying that the capitalists, the police or whatnot, the fascists, whatever it may be, they might well be trying to provoke you, and if you don't have discipline, you're gonna have some guy in your group who's gonna be like, let's get them, and then he starts a fight with them, and then your whole demonstration gets shut down or something like that. So that's another thing about discipline. You need to make sure that everybody's on the same page, understands what they're doing, and that you have control of your own guys. You know your guys have your back. Okay, so then he says, without the fullest and unreserved support from the entire mass of the working class, that is, from all thinking, honest, devoted, and influential elements in it. So that's pretty self-explanatory. You need to have support from the working class for the revolution to be successful and to be able to stay in power. And then he continues, capable of leading the backwards strata or carrying the latter along with them. And this is a pretty good way of putting it. People don't usually think about it like this. He doesn't really ever say this, but when I read this, I get the idea that Lenin sort of imagines the revolution, where at the bottom, you have the broad masses. The workers who don't really know about politics and who don't really care about politics, or who have kind of ignorant views, they might have conservative views. They don't really know what's going on. A lot of peasants and other people like that. And then at the top, you have the workers who are most class conscious. They understand politics. They're Marxists or socialists or whatnot. They're organized. They belong to trade unions. They might belong to the Communist Party. And almost by definition, the most class conscious, the most organized, they tend to be a smaller group. Just by definition, you know, they are the most organized and whatnot, most class conscious. And they also tend to be the most active. The people at the bottom, who are not as organized, and who are not as knowledgeable and don't really care, they're also not very active. So then it falls to the class conscious proletariat to lead everybody else along, or to carry them along, as he says. So you need to find ways of how you're gonna do that. There will come times when you need to mobilize these vast masses of people to do something. And these vast masses, they might support you, but they might not really understand, and they might not be that well organized, and they might not really be that active. But there will come times, like special times, like time of revolution, time of civil war, time of socialist construction, when you build socialism and all that. There will come these times when you need to somehow try to get these people to also come along with you and help you and side with you, even if they don't take like a leadership role or they are not as in the know, as closely involved in, you know, communist activity or something, they at least have to side with you. So it's important to realize this distinction between the people who are active and inactive, and who are politically very conscious and politically not so conscious, and the fact that they can still all be on your side, kinda. Even if the masses sympathize with you, that doesn't mean that they are going to be as active as someone else. Or they might sympathize with you, but not as much as somebody else. So, recap. He says, "It is, I think, almost universally realized at present that the Bolsheviks could not have retained power for 2.5 months, let alone 2.5 years, without the most rigorous and truly iron discipline, without the fullest and unreserved support from the entire mass of the working class." And he specifies, in particular, that is, from all thinking, honest, devoted, and influential elements in it, so the best elements in it, the most advanced elements in it, capable of leading the backward strata or carrying the latter along with them. And what does that mean in practice? The Bolsheviks, they were able to get the majority in the Soviets, to get the influence in the trade unions. In short, they were able to win over not just the working class in general, but they were able to win over the most politically conscious, the most politically active, and the most politically organized members of the working class. And those were the people who really counted. You can be an opportunist politician who's just serving the status quo and doesn't really have anything to say, and you can get the random people on the street to think you're cool. But if you can get some random guy who doesn't know anything to think you're cool, that might serve the status quo, but if you're trying to overthrow the status quo, that's not really gonna help you. Instead, you need to get the organized people to side with you. So that's the point. The Bolsheviks, in particular, needed to win over the advanced section of the working class to the extent that they were even able to carry the not-so-advanced with them to win them over. We will continue from here next time. Thank you very much for watching. Please like and subscribe. All of my social media links are in the description, as well as a link to my Patreon.